knock the crap out of a woodchuck. Seriously, just knock the hell. I promise you, I will pay for the legal fees, I promise. In the good old days, this doesn't happen because they used to treat them very, very rough. And when they protested once, you know, they would not do it again so easily. I love the old days. You know what they used to do to guys like that when they were in a place like this? They'd be carried out in a stretcher, folks.
Expect to punch him in the face.
Donald Trump during the campaign of 2016. Well, can authoritarianism or fascism happen here in the U.S.? That was what we talked about earlier this week with Cass Sunstein, who is the editor of a new book called Can It Happen Here? Here's the interview I did with Cass Sunstein. Professor Sunstein, welcome to WMNF. Great to have you here.
Pleasure to be here.
I want to ask you, because when Sinclair Lewis wrote his satirical novel, It Can't Happen Here, he was talking about fascism. Are you talking about fascism in this book and the possibility it could come to the U.S.?
Absolutely. That's the question, and the different contributors to the book have different answers.
How would you describe what fascism is?
I describe it in a kind of colloquial way as a system where the government has unbounded authority. So a system where the leader of the country can invade property rights, can abridge freedom of speech, can interfere with freedom of religion. Basically, the untrammeled authority of the center is the defining characteristic, as I would understand it, of fascism. There are more technical definitions, but that's kind of good enough.
Your book is filled with optimists and pessimists on that question about whether or not it could come here. Who were some of the people that contributed to your book?
Well, we have the leading thinker, really, on freedom of speech in the world, Jeffrey Stone, who's from Chicago, and he is the best theorist there is, and so he's one author. We have, arguably, the best social scientist in the world from Norway, a guy named Jan Elster, who writes about some history where authoritarianism flowered. We have Jack Goldsmith, who worked as a principal lawyer in the Bush administration, who works on foreign policy and writes about that. And my personal favorite, I confess, is Samantha Power, former U.S. ambassador to the United Nations and a great thinker on foreign policy. And she's my personal favorite because I'm married to her.
Okay, well, that's a good reason. So you're one of the optimists in the book, if I can characterize you that way. Why are you optimistic that the U.S. Cannot turn to fascism?
I would say we have a fantastic safeguard against fascism, and that is our system of separation of powers. And this is exactly how Hamilton and Madison saw it originally. That is, we have an independent judiciary, which can stop presidential and legislative action that invades liberty or property. And we also have a dependence of the president on Congress, so that president can't do something without congressional authorization. And we have dependence of Congress on the president, in the sense that if the president says, no, I'm not going to do that horrific thing, he can probably get away with it. And these elaborate systems of safeguards that are structures, not just rights, they are, I think, ultimately very powerful protections for the American people.
That sort of presumes that everybody stays in their lane, so to speak, that Congress does its job but doesn't overstep its job, the president does his job and doesn't overstep. I can remember during the Obama administration, conservatives were very upset that the president was using executive orders to carry out some of his policy. Now, I think a lot of liberals are upset at President Trump's use of his power, especially to roll back those executive orders. I mean, is it possible for the president to exert a lot of power and maybe overstep his lane?
It's possible, but it's tough. So let's take them in sequence. So President Obama's use of executive orders and executive authority overwhelmingly upheld by the courts. So there were complaints that in doing things about greenhouse gas emissions, the president had made a mistake by not going to Congress, made a kind of awful mistake. He acted in violation of the law. But by and large, his actions on climate change are completely within the authority given by the Clean Air Act, and the Supreme Court said that in the case involving the Clean Air Act. They said greenhouse gases are a pollutant. So that was fine. Things that the president did under the Affordable Care Act overwhelmingly, they were authorized by the Affordable Care Act. So if you go down the list, the number of cases where the president acted plainly in violation of his legal authority, and talking about President Obama, I think zero. The act where he, cases where he acted in the end, yes, it did exceed his authority. The number is not zero, but it's not really high. So, and that's what the judiciary said, and that's what lawyers who investigated the issues would generally say. For President Trump, basically, as of this call, I'd say exactly the same thing. That is, President Trump's actions in general have either been within his legal authority, or if they've been outside his legal authority, he at least had an argument that they were inside his legal authority. So the use of regulation as executive orders is something that is time-honored and is part of our system, and there are checks. Then the ultimate check is the judiciary's power to say what the law is, which means that the president ultimately has to stay in his lane, and the courts will insist on that. Now, we've had domains in our history where the president did apparently stay within his legal lane, but in turn, Japanese Americans. And that was a shameful part of our history. And sometimes presidents can stay in their lanes, but the lane is pretty big, and that can be a threat to freedom. And we saw that, I think, in the Watergate era, where sometimes President Nixon did go outside of his lane, and sometimes even acting within his lane, he did things that are, let's say, inconsistent with our best traditions.
Just jumping out a little bit, has the U.S. Supreme Court ever ruled on Japanese internment? Did it ever find that that was in violation of the Constitution?
Yes and no, respectively. It ruled on it and ruled it was okay. So that was maybe a lesson about the caution of the judiciary in the face of a national security threat, even if just a perceived national security threat. So for those who think, as I do, that we can trust the courts probably in the face of something awful, the fact that the Supreme Court in this case basically capitulated to the Reagan administration, that's alarming.
We're talking with Cass Sunstein about his new book. He just edited a book called Can It Happen Here? Authoritarianism in America. In the book, he and about 19 other legal scholars and First Amendment advocates look at the question about whether or not fascism can come to the U.S. Cass, I want to ask you about cheerleading by the president during President Trump's campaign. There was a lot of cheering on of violence and that sort of thing. During the Tea Party era, you could go to some Tea Party rallies and see oath keepers who were armed with weapons saying that they were there to defend the Constitution. Leading up to that, I want to play an ad from the NRA that's out this week touting a new NRA TV show. This is Dana Loesch from the NRA.
We've had enough of the lies, the sanctimony, the arrogance, the hatred, the pettiness, the fake news. We are done with your agenda to undermine voters' will and individual liberty in America. So to every lying member of the media, to every Hollywood phony, to the role model athletes who use their free speech to alter and undermine what our flag represents, to the politicians who would rather watch America burn than lose 1 ounce of their own personal power, to the late-night hosts who think their opinions are the only opinions that matter, to the Joanne Reeds, the Morning Joes, the Mikas, to those who stain honest reporting with partisanship, to those who bring bias and propaganda to CNN, the Washington Post, and the New York Times, your time is running out. The clock starts now.
Well, that's an NRA ad that's out right now with Dana Loesch. Professor Sunstein, do you think that that's a call to fascism?
No, and I think that, you know, we have a system of free speech that the NRA is completely entitled to take advantage of, and tough talk is completely part of our system. The thing I don't like about that I wouldn't say is fascistic, but which is beyond the pale, is your time is running out. That's what you say to someone who you're going to kill, or some, you might say it in sadness to someone who's dying, and to say that to the New York Times or to media, your time is running out. Don't do that. There's violence in those words. Your time is running out. And I really respect the NRA, I should say. And I think on some issues they're entirely wrong, but they're part of our system, and this is not something that is consistent with their own best traditions. You know, I worked for President Obama for 4 years, and then I worked for him actually a little more in a part-time capacity, and I feel that someone who worked for President Obama, it's kind of incumbent on us, this is just my personal view, to be as gracious to his successor as possible. So I took him to be doing these things not as literally wanting people to be hit or punched, but as more expressive of, I don't like that dissent in my presence. Now, you're right that some of it did seem to cross a line. So I would be very surprised if President Trump or any president of the United States did stuff of the sort you're describing. But we've had some bad surprises, including from President Trump, describing the press as enemy of the people. And if President Obama or, let's say, a future Democratic president did that, that would be horrific. And I hope Democrats would say that. To describe the FBI as a partisan entity in circumstances in which it really isn't that, is that crosses a line also. And President Trump has done that. And these things aren't, you know, they aren't fascist, but they are echoing authoritarian, talk. And we don't want that from our elected leader.
We're almost out of time, but it is, I mean, you have a lot of faith in the institutions, that if the institutions survive and they can stand up to any assault on democracy.
I do, with one qualification. I should say I'm one of the most optimistic in the book. The qualification is that if we the people aren't kind of fiercely protective of our rights, then our institutions are unlikely to be enough. So our institutions need us as the ultimate sovereign.
Well, Professor Cass Sunstein, thanks a lot. I guess we're not going to see The Handmaid's Tale in real life anytime soon.
Not tomorrow, not the day after tomorrow, maybe on television.
All right, Cass Sunstein, the editor of the book, Can It Happen Here? Authoritarianism in America. Thanks for coming on WMNF.
Thank you, a pleasure. Thanks, enjoyed it.
Thank you.
Great
me question. Too. Time's up. We only had about 10 or 15 minutes for the interview. He was rushing to do a bunch of interviews that day. His classic projection, pretending its perceived enemy is doing what it's doing.